Yo, what's up? This is Patrick from Guy in the Cube, and in this video, I'm going to show you how to tame the beast that is DAX. Stay tuned. If you're finding this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam and this guy. Okay, so DAX. Every time I talk to people about DAX, they go, DAX is so hard. It's not hard, it's just challenging. And it's especially challenging if you're not familiar with all the functions that are available inside DAX that could help you solve problems. We got a question on a live stream recently, and someone asked this question, and I was like, man, this is not too difficult to solve. But that made me think, you know what, people, you know, when they're trying to do things with DAX, if they just understood the functions that are available, they probably can do these things really quickly. So I decided to do a video on it to show you a way to not only familiarize yourself with these functions, but to also use these functions and hopefully tame the beast that is DAX. All right, so enough of all this talking. You guys know what I like to do. Let's do what? Let's head over to my laptop. So we got a question. They said, hey, if I have a list of clients that I visit every month, can you show me a fraction for every client that was visited in the last 3 months? So if I visited a client 3 times, so right now it's March 2021. So if I visited them in March and February and January, it should be 3/3. If I didn't visit them in any of those 3 months, it would be 0/3. And if I visited them twice, maybe I visited them in January and February, it'd be 2/3. Okay. So how do you write this measure? And so I'm going to be honest with you guys. My very first attempt at this produced some DAX that looked like this. And we're not going to go all into this DAX. It was just so much DAX. This kind of proves the point. If you're familiar with the functions, you probably can do things simpler. But moreover, when you're writing your DAX, it can be an iterative process because you can start with something really complex and then dwindle it down, not only to make it less code, but probably make it more performant. The first thing I do is I understand what the person or the report consumer, whoever it is that's asking for the DAX, you know, make sure you understand what they're asking for. And then what I like to do is I create a sample set. If it's in a relational database, I write a query that returns a small amount of data. If it's not, and they just tell me about it, like in this case from the live stream, I just use Excel, which is the best input tool ever, and just kind of make some fake data. So you can see here, I have a list of clients and the dates I visited them, and then I have a client list. If you want to follow along, this spreadsheet and the sample PBIX file should be available where? In the comments below. So I get the data loaded and then I can start, you know, writing my measure right here. Create a measure and I start writing the DAX. Don't do that, especially if you're not familiar with the functions, you're not quite sure what to do. My recommendation is download DAX Studio and start using DAX Studio. I did a video on why I like to use DAX Studio when I'm writing my measures. You should go check that video out. It's a really good video. Once it's installed and ready to go, I'll go ahead and launch DAX Studio. And the first thing that I like to do is try to simulate the data that Power BI is gonna use to create the visual. So if it's a table, if it's a bar chart, I try to write a query that's gonna be very similar to that. In this case, they wanna see the client name. Instead of writing query, because they just wanna see a list of clients, I mean, I can freehand this out. I got some skills. But what you can do is you can use the query builder, and all I wanna do is see the client name. So I'm gonna do that and say edit queries. And immediately, it's gonna give me my query. Don't need the query builder anymore. I also have a video on how to use a query builder, so you should go check that one out too if you're not familiar with the query builder. So let's just close this first. So now if I run this query, it's just a list of my clients, which is perfect. But the very first time I did this, I saw this summarize columns and I was like, what is this summarize columns? What is this function? And so if you go over here to the left pane, you'll see a couple of tabs, DMV, metadata, but here's one called functions. What I like about this is it categorizes the functions. I can expand and just kind of review them, or I can just search. So summarize columns is the one that I'm interested in. If I hover over it, it gives me a tooltip that shows me the list of parameters that it accepts. If you go in the white space, so let's just go outside of this query and double click, boom, it writes it out for you and provides the inputs. If you want to know more about this function, you just go right after the function name, enter a parentheses, and it gives you more tooltip that shows you, you know, actually what the function does. But what's really cool, if I click this, this, it opens up a page that goes straight to DAX.guy that gives me tons of information about this function. It tells me what it is. It tells me the parameters that it accepts. Hey, these are optional repeatable parameters. And what that means is I can have multiple group by columns, multiple filter tables. And this is a pair. These two are a pair, the name and expression. So you provide the name and the expression, but I can have multiple pairs of these combinations, and they're all absolutely optional. And then what I like, it tells me what it returns. It returns a table. This is the beginning of me writing a query. And so I'm not teaching you how to write the query. I'm not teaching you how to write DAX in this video. I'm showing you how to learn the functions, you know, learn about the functions that are available and the capabilities that are available in DAX so that you can write your own query, so that you can learn how to write DAX, okay? I'm familiar with summarized columns. I've been using it a lot. You know, there's some inputs here, but I don't really care about the filter table quite yet. What I want to focus on right now is the expression. And so the expression is the actual measure. In my case, right, whenever I use this, the expression represents the measure that I'm gonna create over in Power BI Desktop. So I have the list of clients, and now I wanna create the measure. I'm gonna call it visits. And right now I wanna count the number of visits. Let's get rid of that. We don't need that anymore. And then I'm gonna add my expression. We'll start at count rows. So you type count rows. And again, when I type parentheses, I can go out to DAX.guy and review what count rows is. I see that count rows takes a table. I wanna do client visits. IntelliSense is built directly into DAX Studio, or you can go to the metadata tab, find the table that you wanna count the rows for, double click it, and boom, just like that. I format my DAX up. I like to format the DAX because it kind of gives me a check of the syntax. I can do long or short line. If I do short line, it kind of breaks it out even more. And then I can run my query. And now I can see that client one was visited 4 times, client two was visited 3 times, on and so forth. This is one of the primary reasons I like to make a small data set, because I can go and validate this. And sure enough, client one was 4 times, client two was 3 times, client three was 3 times, and client four was 2x. And I can validate that back with my results. I know this can be a tedious process, but the more and more you do this, the more you'll become familiar with those functions and the easier it'll become to write these expressions. Okay, so back to our challenge here. Now, in addition to count rows, I only wanna look at this for the last 3 months. So I head back to my functions, we'll clear this out. And now you can see that there's, you know, lots of categories. Because I'm filtering this by time, it immediately drew me to the date time folder. And there's lots of different functions here. So I'm really looking for a function that'll provide that, you know, that 3 month filter. And I kind of went through all these. What's great, you can hover over them. You know, it shows you the inputs. Like I said, you can double click them. It'll take you out. I ended up with the dates and period. The dates and period is the second input. I'm gonna go ahead and place it right there. And then it says, all right, what do you wanna do? So it wants a list of dates. If you go out and look at the documentation for it, so if I add my parentheses here, if you need more information, again, you can go out to DAX.guy and it'll give you all the details about it. It returns the dates for a given period. The first column is a column reference, right? So I have a calendar table. So I just provided a list of my dates and then I add the rest of the values there. So let's do this. Calendar date. And then the next one is the date I want to start, which could be today. You can do lots of things with this. And then I want to go back 3 months and the interval, which will be month. And don't forget your comma. Let's format this up, which does a nice syntax check for me, and run the query. So now it removed number 3, but I kept 1, 2, and 4. So let's go check it. I go back. Yep, 1 has some stuff in February, March, and January. 2 doesn't have any in March, February, January, and 3 does. Why did it pick up 2? I'm not sure, right? I'm not sure. And this is where knowing the functions and knowing the capabilities that are available in DAX can really help you out. Let me show you what I'm talking about. So if I head back over to DAX Studio, I can take this right here, because I remember I read in the documentation that this returns a table, open up a new window connected to the same model, choose evaluate, and paste this in, and then I'll run this query. Why is this returning December? Let's scroll down. Let's see what the results are. Let's go all the way down here. Oh, because it's going from like a 90-day kind of thing. So I don't want that. I want it to return March, February, and January, and there's probably several ways that I can solve this, but I thought of a way, and I actually, you know, one of my steps when I'm writing DAX, because I don't profess to be this DAX expert. I know a lot about it, but not an expert like Marco and Alberto and Phil C. Mark. Sometimes I'll ping run things by them, and I actually ran this by Phil the other day, and he was like, ah, spot on, Patrick, spot on. So let me show you what I came up with. Instead of just using today, what I decided to do was do this, right? And you can use this little constructor because evaluate expects a table, and I can turn a scalar function into a table by using this little constructor. There's a function called end of the month. It returns the date in a daytime format of the last day of the month. And so I'm going to put in today and then I'll run this. And you can see, what did I miss? My bad. It accepts an additional parameter about, you know, where I want to start, but I want to start right at the day that I'm on, the month that I'm on. So there we go. 331. This pushes me all the way to the end of March. So I should start at the beginning of 3 months from now, which would be January. So let's just take this, replace today with EOM. And now let's run this and let's see what we get. Voila. So now it goes back to January and it'll go all the way out to March. So it's only going to give me visits from January to March. So let's copy this, head back to this guy right here and replace it with that, add my comma, and let's run this. There we go, 1 and 4. Like I said, this is an iterative process. You'll have to, you know, do this over, but you debug using DAX Studio. You can actually use SQL Server Management Studio to do this. It just doesn't have the tight integration with all the functions the way maybe I haven't dug into it, but I know DAX Studio does. But if you don't have DAX Studio, you can write queries like this using SQL Server Management Studio. Like I said, I use DAX Studio because it has a better integration with all the functions. All right. Remember what I said at the beginning, this right here, I'm going to put a little comment just so everybody will know this part is your measure. I want to take this little guy over to Power BI Desktop and use it as my measure. Even though I know this accepts this filter, what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this filter, and there is a function, calculate. You should go read about it, know it, love it, live it. Probably going to be one of the most used functions in your DAX code because you can pass the filter here and calculate. While I'm simulating the environment here in DAX Studio, when I go over to Power BI Desktop, I don't need that simulation anymore. So I need all that information consolidated in a single expression. And so you can see right here, I'm doing the count rows and I'm passing the exact same filter that I was passing using summarized columns to my calculate. So now if I run this, I get the exact same expression, which is really, really cool. So now I need to wrap this up and add the fraction part of it. Remember, I said that this is the expression I'm gonna bring over to Power BI Desktop. And so I wanna use some variables, and you can absolutely use variables in the summarized columns. You just need to know the syntax. So this is gonna be my last 3 months equal. And then all you need to do, I'm gonna get this on my clipboard. I'm gonna type return, and then I'm gonna drop this here. Watch what happens. It runs, format it up, perfect. So then I wanna add one more variable, which is actually gonna be my result, or result equals. And what I'm gonna do is use another function, because I have been using this function list right here to learn all about these functions. And basically it's gonna return the first argument that does not evaluate to a blank value. So let me show you what I'm talking about. So we'll get this back on our clipboard. And in my case, if it's blank, return a zero. Because if I didn't visit in the last 3 months, they want to show a zero. If I did, they wanna show the actual number. And that's what this is gonna do. So now I replace the last 3 months in my return with result, and run that. And now you can see that I'm returning 2 and 3 because I didn't actually visit them, but they wanted to show that. That was part of the requirement. And now all I have to do is to do the fraction and say &3. And you may be thinking, wait, it's a number and a string. It'll convert it for me. Trust me, it'll convert it for me. Run this and boom, there's my result. You could do this too if you know the functions, right? I'm not teaching you how to write DAX. I'm teaching you how to learn how to write DAX. And that is by understanding the functions. The first step is understanding the function. The second step, make a small data set that you can use, then validate, iterate. It will absolutely help you write your queries. And like I said, this is the expression that'll make my measure. Let's make sure everything's formatted. Copy this, go back over to Power BI Desktop, new measure, final 3 months equal, paste that in there, make sure it's right. And I'm just gonna pop it next to that really long one that I wrote, and the result should be exactly the same. What do you guys think, right? The challenge in DAX, the beast that is DAX. How are you tackling and how are you learning DAX? I'd love to know. Did this help you out? Of course I'd love to know. Let's continue the conversation. Where? In the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like my video, big thumbs up. As always, from Adam and myself, thanks for watching. See you in the next video.